huge sphere of 12.756 kilometers in radius is moving rapidly in the space in a speed of almost 68,000 miles per hour. It is called the Earth. The Earth is surrounded by an atmosphere of five layers, consisting of hydrogen, oxygen, and inert gases. At the same time, the Earth rotates around its axis at 1,000 miles per hour. I will not speak about the greatness of the universe or the incredible galaxies, which the Earth looks like a speck of dust on the foothill of Everest in comparison to them. And I will not speak about the countless numbers of light years with endless zeros. I have heard a lot of talking from the atheists in the world, but the thing they say, and I did not understand until now, is that they do not believe in God because they cannot see him. I do not know how they cannot see him, while I can see the creation of God all the time, in every inch around me. Why does water have very unique properties in comparison to all other liquids? Why does Earth rotate in definite speed and in an accurate angle? Example, 23.5 degrees. Why is the sun located at such an enormous distance and has such high temperature? Why the atmosphere has certain components in specific measures? When you ponder on the answers to these questions, you will see the great creator revealing himself clearly. The Earth rotates around its axis at 1,000 miles per hour. Assuming that this speed decreases to 200 miles per hour, for instance, our night and day times would be 10 times longer. The temperature at the daytime would continue to increase till we burn, and the temperature at the night would continue to decrease until we freeze. Humans would not be able to organize their time, sleep, and work during the very long daylights or the darkness of night. All of the measures in this planet are regularized and adjusted for the benefits of one creature, the only creature that has a mind capable of understanding and realizing. Is there a message to us from the one who has created all this? Why the only liquid necessary for life is also the only liquid that decreases in density when it freezes and then it floats? If water was exactly like the rest of liquids in terms of characteristics, the seas, rivers, and oceans would totally freeze, and fish and animals of seas and oceans would die. Without the sun, we would not be able to live on this planet. It is a sterilizer and light. The temperature on the surface of the sun is 12,000 degrees Fahrenheit, and the distance between the sun and Earth is nearly 93 million miles. This enormous distance is constant. It never changes, whether to increase or decrease. If it decreases and the sun becomes nearer to the Earth, half of the distance, for example, the paper and wood will immediately burn. And if the distance increases to the double, the severe coldness which will happen because of the big distance will end life on Earth. If you realize these facts, you will also realize that there is a merciful Lord that organized such delicate, punctual messiahs on our planet in a system that suits us in a specific way to make our lives easy and smooth. This Earth rotates around the sun in an angle of 23.5 degrees. This leads to the succession of seasons, and it also causes the suitability of the land for cultivation and housing. If Earth was not rotating in such accurate angle, the seasons would remain constant in every part of the Earth, and darkness would cover the two poles. The steam of seas will travel to the north and south. The snowy mountains will spread in some regions, and the arid deserts in other regions.
The only way to avoid this is the rotation of the Earth in the space at an angle of 23.5 degrees. If the atmosphere has less thickness or different components, the meteors that we see bright at night, moving in the space 90 times faster than the bullet, would have penetrated the atmosphere, burning everything on Earth. The amazing thing is that the atmosphere only allows very nominal amounts of solar radiation, important for the growth of plants, elimination of germs, and other needs for the Earth. Is nature capable of regulating all these specific measurements and definite dates to suit us? This balance of quantities needed for the life on Earth is very amazing. The air consists of six gases, 78% nitrogen and 21% oxygen. Why these gases were formed in such accurate percentages to be suitable to our lives and exactly as needed? If this existence was not under the dominance of a mighty, great, and wise creator, then why does it have such amazing, balanced soul? As if everything is just gathered to play a harmonious symphony. This symphony is only for us. The answer is quite simple. He is the ever wise. He is the ever magnificent. He is the ever great. He is the ever merciful. He is the omnipotent. He is the generous. He is the ever affectionate. He is the ever glorious, the eternal owner of sovereignty, the owner of majesty and bounty. He is Allah.
In 1966, Time magazine ran a cover story asking, "Is God dead?" The cover reflected the fact that many people had accepted the cultural narrative that God is obsolete, that as science progresses, there's less need for a God to explain the universe. It turns out, though, that the rumors of God's death were premature. In fact, perhaps the best arguments for his existence come from, of all places, science itself. Here's the story. The same year Time featured its now famous headline, the astronomer Carl Sagan announced that there were two necessary criteria for a planet to support life: the right kind of star and a planet the right distance from that star. Given the roughly octillion planets in the universe, that's one followed by 24 zeros, there should have been about septillion planets, that's one followed by 21 zeros, capable of supporting life. With such spectacular odds, scientists were optimistic that the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, known by its initials SETI, an ambitious project launched in the 1960s, was sure to turn up something soon. With a vast radio telescopic network, scientists listened for signals that resembled coded intelligence. But as the years passed, the silence from the universe was deafening. As of 2014, researchers have discovered precisely bupkis, nada, zilch, which is to say zero, followed by an infinite number of zeros. What happened? As our knowledge of the universe increased, it became clear that there were, in fact, far more factors necessary for life, let alone intelligent life, than Sagan supposed. His two parameters grew to 10, then 20, and then 50, which meant that the number of potentially life-supporting planets decreased accordingly. The number dropped to a few thousand planets and kept on plummeting. Even SETI proponents acknowledged the problem. Peter Schenkel wrote in a 2006 piece for Skeptical Inquirer, a magazine that strongly affirms atheism, "In light of new findings and insights, we should quietly admit that the early estimates may no longer be tenable." Today, there are more than 200 known parameters necessary for a planet to support life, every single one of which must be perfectly met or the whole thing falls apart. For example, without a massive gravity-rich planet like Jupiter nearby to draw away asteroids, Earth would be more like an interstellar dartboard than the verdant orb that it is. Simply put, the odds against life in the universe are astonishing. Yet, here we are, not only existing, but talking about existing. What can account for it? Can every one of those many parameters have been perfectly met by accident? At what point is it fair to admit that it is science itself that suggests that we cannot be the result of random forces? Doesn't assuming that an intelligence created these perfect conditions in fact require far less faith than believing that a life-sustaining Earth just happened to beat the inconceivable odds? But wait, there's more. The fine-tuning necessary for life to exist on a planet is nothing compared with the fine-tuning required for the universe to exist at all. For example, astrophysicists now know that the values of the four fundamental forces, gravity, the electromagnetic force, and the strong and weak nuclear forces, were determined less than 1/1,000,000th of a second after the Big Bang. Alter any one of these four values ever so slightly, and the universe as we know it could not exist. For instance, if the ratio between the strong nuclear force and the electromagnetic force had been off by the tiniest fraction of the tiniest inconceivable fraction, then no stars could have formed at all. Multiply that single parameter by all the other necessary conditions, and the odds against the universe existing are so heart-stoppingly astronomical that the notion that it all just happened defies common sense. It would be like tossing a coin and having it come up heads 10 quintillion times in a row. I don't think so. Fred Hoyle, the astronomer who coined the term Big Bang, said that his atheism was greatly shaken by these developments. One of the world's most renowned theoretical physicists, Paul Davies, has said that the appearance of design is overwhelming. Even the late Christopher Hitchens, one of atheism's most aggressive proponents, conceded that without question, the fine-tuning argument was the most powerful argument of the other side. Oxford University professor of mathematics, Dr. John Lennox, has said, "The more we get to know about our universe, the more the hypothesis that there is a creator gains in credibility as the best explanation of why we are here." The greatest miracle of all time is the universe. It is the miracle of all miracles, one that inescapably points to something or someone beyond itself. I'm Eric Metaxas for Prager University.